one Christian church based on the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, and the Athanasian Creed. All of these codified so that people knew what Christians believed, not only about who Jesus is and who the Trinity is, but how salvation is delivered by Jesus himself on the cross and through his sacraments. Of this, there was no doubt for thousands of years. Now, what happened was, because of the corruption of the church at the time, and the corruption was widespread, yes, but it was not total. There were always people, bishops and leaders, who were truly and sincerely involved in promoting the Christian religion. And so it's a great mistake to imagine that the entire church was corrupt. That isn't true. Around the year 1500 or so, we're just going to call it that year, there was a man by the name of Dr. Martin Luther, who was a very sincere soul. He was a Roman Catholic priest and became a professor of theology and knew several languages, and he was quite a brilliant man. And as the centuries passed, these states began to form in Europe: France, Germany, Italy, Spain, Portugal, England. All of these states began to form, and they began to assert their right as states. They did not want the Pope to be the acting emperor of Europe anymore. And so there was a great sentiment to unseat the Pope from this position. So the people themselves were tired of being dominated by a church that had become corrupted on the outside, but truly the protectors of the truth on the inside. And so Martin Luther, seeing all the abuses and all of the corruptions that had accrued to the church like barnacles to a ship sailing across the ocean vast, decided that he would have a debate about these abuses and see what he could do in order to help correct these abuses. And so he named 95 abuses that he thought needed to be addressed and nailed them to the bulletin board of that day in Wittenberg, which was the church door, and wanted these questions to be debated. Martin Luther did not mean to overthrow the Roman Church. He did not mean to overthrow Christianity. He meant to cleanse it, to reform it, by removing the abuses. And so he nailed his 95 theses, or 95 ideas of the things that needed to be corrected so that the church could get back like it was during the time of the apostles, with true doctrine, true government of the church, and the truth of Christ, Christ alone, Scripture alone, faith alone. Well, the Gutenberg press had been invented, and when Martin Luther put his theses on the door, people copied it immediately, and thousands of copies were circulated all throughout Germany and France and all different parts of Europe. And all the people began to want to know the answers to these questions. Well, of course, this caused quite a stir, because the Pope of Rome was still extremely powerful and was able to cooperate with some of the leaders of the emerging European states, especially Spain. And so he was extremely powerful and influenced the leaders at the time to call Martin Luther to account for questioning his authority and for causing all the commotion in Germany. Germany was an emerging group of states that had not completely unified, but yet they were showing their nationalism, and the Pope wanted that crushed as soon as possible. And so he wanted the Lutherans, Martin Luther in particular, he wanted him in particular, together with Philip Melanchthon, his partner, to give an answer for themselves. Thus began the Lutheran Reformation. Martin Luther appeared before the Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, Charles V, through his mediaries, and certainly made his statements in person, that he would not retract his desire to see the church reformed and would never change his mind. This cracked open an egg. So I want you to look at the church family tree and see that there was one Christian church with all of its faults and flaws and benefits. There was one Christian church until Martin Luther opened up these questions. When he opened up these questions and demanded the removal of the abuses that were ever present and causing so much trouble, the church at that point fragmented. At that point, the Western church fragmented because so many people wanted the answers to these questions, as did Martin Luther. But the answer of the Pope and his emissaries was highly, highly deficient. And because their answers were highly deficient, the people did not buy them. They didn't believe them. And so Martin Luther, protected by the German states, especially in Saxony, began to formulate what is to be believed by Christians to be consistent with the Athanasian, Nicene, and Apostles' Creeds. And the doctrine set forth by Martin Luther was an effort to cleanse the doctrine of the church, which had accrued many false and fallacious doctrines, including the doctrine of purgatory, including the doctrine of intercession of the saints, and many of the things that had been accrued to the church over the centuries. Thus was born Lutheranism. Of course, this did not set well with a powerful pope, nor with his secular leaders who depended on his support. And so, of course, a war ensued. And the war was bloody, and the war was ugly. But Martin Luther had opened Pandora's box. Because now, while he was under persecution himself, Martin Luther put the Bible in German. And because of the Gutenberg press, the Bible was being circulated all over the world, and especially in Germany. Before, manuscripts had to be copied laboriously by hand in monasteries, by monks who dedicated their lives to that inscriptorium's copy, 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 again and again. What a devoted bunch of people. But when the Gutenberg press came along, it made the Bible available to everyone, and they began to read it for themselves, whereas before the extremely expensive copies of the Holy Scripture were not only in Latin, but were chained to the pulpits in the churches so they couldn't be stolen, they were too valuable. Because the Bible was now available in a way where people could read it for themselves, people began to realize that Luther's questions were not small. They were not insignificant. In fact, Luther was calling everyone back to the doctrines of the Holy Scripture. Now, this did not only happen in Germany. So let's look at our family tree. We've got the Christian Church, the Roman Catholic Church. Then you have the first branch, which is Luther. But there was a fellow over in Switzerland by the name of Calvin. And John Calvin, taking the lead of Luther, since Luther had already cracked the egg and had already circulated the Bible and had already opened the door to standing up against the Roman Church and its power and its ability to have you burned at the stake if you disagreed, John Calvin took hold of that, and he interpreted the Scriptures himself and wrote his own version of the truth of what the Bible taught. And John Calvin wrote these books that would explain, according to his way of thinking, what the Bible taught about just about everything. This is called Calvin's Institutes. And so John Calvin in Switzerland began then, right then, Calvinism. So if you look at the family tree, you have the Roman Catholic Church, Then below, the first branch is Lutheranism, the second, Calvinism, and then over in England, King Henry VIII, separated by the English Channel, decided that he too would join the fracas, and so he broke away from the Roman Church also, only he did so much more aggressively and made himself the head of the Church of England. And so you have the English Church, or the Church of England, which is now known as the Episcopal Church, the Church of England or the Episcopal Church. So these are the three main headwaters. If you want to say, these are our grandparents or great-great-grandparents, Lutheranism, Calvinism, and the Church of England. Now let's follow each one of these, because some of these names are going to start sounding very familiar to you. We'll come back to Lutheranism in a moment, but let's start with Calvin. Calvin decided that the way of running the congregations had nothing to do with bishops. Calvin was a Protestant, which meant that he was protesting the entire Roman Catholic Church, including the Athanasian Creed, the Nicene Creed, and the Apostles' Creed. And so he was protesting the existence of the Roman Church and was against any kind of ornate decorations in the church, against anything that would remind anybody of the Roman Church, which had been corrupted and which had been very violent, especially in the Inquisitions in Spain. And so he protested the entire Christian church. He was a Protestant. Luther was a reformer. King Henry VIII was a separatist, not to mention most likely a narcissist. John Calvin said that churches should be governed independently by presbyteries, or groups of men, not a bishop, but groups of men, hence the Presbyterian Church. And so John Calvin, because of the church government being the presbytery, which comes from the Latin, which means the older fellows or the elders would run the church, those with presbyopia and need reading glasses, became the Presbyterians. Now, the Presbyterians did very well, actually, and began to spread all over Europe. And many people began to see the light of John Calvin as the way out of the morass of the now crumbling Roman Catholic Church. Except for one fellow who was in the same country, Switzerland, by the name of Ulrich Zwingli. Zwingli did not think that Calvin went far enough, and he started having a Bible study of his own. He was a preacher also, and started having a Bible study with a fellow by the name of Hubmaier. His Bible study group decided that John Calvin had not gone far enough. They rejected infant baptism. They rejected the idea that baptism is salvific. They rejected many of the Christian doctrines which had been held for thousands of years. And they became what is known as the Anabaptists, or the baptizers again, those who want to baptize when you're older. Not infant baptism, but rebaptizers, Anabaptists. Well, this was too much even for Zwingli. And so he began to persecute the Anabaptists, who began to be led by a fellow by the name of Menno Simons, hence Mennonites. So these persecuted people fled Switzerland, and they finally made it to England, where they became known as Baptists. So you can see that the Presbyterians and the Baptists have a real connection. Even to this day, many Baptists are more Calvinist than they are in line with any kind of Orthodox Christian teaching. Among them was a man by the name of Arminius, who went even farther and rejected many of the doctrines of Calvin and said, It is our own choice.